Hey, historians. So glad you're taking a moment out of your schedule to join me for this brief review of period four. Unlike period three, which is it's huge, along with period seven, period four is a little smaller in time, but certainly densely packed with a lot of information. So we'll divide this period in half so it's a lot easier for you to process it. Without further ado, let's go ahead and take a look at our slideshow today to kind of set us up for our discussion on period four. You're taking a look at a John Gast oil canvas painting. From 1872, John Gast painted this and called it American Progress. And just a casual look at it, you'll see the industrial Northeast in the Northeast part of the painting, complete with the island of Manhattan and the commerce of the ships going in and out of the Hudson River. We've got the trains that are moving out of the industrial Northeast and heading west, and the farmers there in the southern part of the painting continuing to do their part to fulfill the agrarian ideals of a Jeffersonian society. The stagecoaches and the prospectors moving west, and they're in the centerpiece of the painting, Columbia herself, taking telecommunications and progress to the west. And John Gast purposefully had what is called a gradient in art, which there was a very light depiction of the sky and the optimism of that painting on the right side, slowly gradient over to a dark and ominous storm clouds and the Rocky Mountains, the formidable geographic barrier that's going to require people to get over to get to the west. And as that progress continues, we're going to see carcasses of cattle and the Native Americans running for their life along with the buffalo. So a lot to take in here, and certainly an easy depiction for us to step back and look. And even though it was painted in the latter part of the 19th century, typically when we speak of things like Manifest Destiny, John O'Sullivan's treatise on us being destined for the West Coast, we typically go to this picture to give us that visualization for what is happening in period four. So we begin with a destined America today. I'd like to take a look at what could be potential DBQ topics for period four. Remember, the AP exam for the 2020 year is going to be modified in 10 specific parts throughout the rubric. And I like to look, in, for instance, at period three, we said it could be French and Indian War, or the subsequent revenue acts that followed the French and Indian War to pay for Britain's debt. We could have the American Revolution itself as a potential DBQ topic. Constitutionality, the Articles of Confederation, and getting to the ratification of the Constitution, or even the early growing pains of a new nation, the French and British foreign entanglements, along with the Barbary Wars and the Jeffersonian kind of ideals. And that really gives us a bridge into period four, where we pick up our story with that Jeffersonian democracy. But before we do, some potential topics to look at might be, you know, the War of 1812. I don't necessarily see the College Board giving us something as micro-focused as the War of 1812, but maybe as a launching point to getting us into a broader time period in American history, and that is the era of good feelings. We'll take some time to talk about that today. Perhaps Jackson's presidency, the Jacksonian age, or the age of Jackson, on how he expanded the power of the executive branch specifically. Some lampooned him as King Andrew I. Maybe he was addressing a democracy, really reaching out to the everyday common man as the Democratic Republicans under Jefferson became just the Democrats under Andrew Jackson. And once that requirement for owning land for white males was removed, that greatly increased suffrage in the country. We might look kind of like we were looking at the John Gast portrait just a few minutes ago about territorial expansion. What are some of the advances that we see with territorial acquisitions or compromises like the Missouri Compromise or, for instance, the Mexican Cession, Oregon Territory, Texas? How is that progress and various documents could perhaps show the extent to which the American territorial land was expanding west? You could couple that with either territorial expansion or even economic expansion. What's happening under Henry Clay's American system, or for instance, the market revolution? Or lastly, we could look at the extent to which the issue of slavery began to surface in the midst of period four. It's not at the forefront of the discussion as much as it is, of course, in period five, but slavery is going to be a big part of the discussion, certainly with the Missouri Compromise and the Talmadge Amendment, and post-Mexican-American War and what to do with the territory west of the Rocky Mountains. Well, let's take a look at period four. And today we're really going to divide it up into two parts. But this does set the stage for all of period four, from 1800 to 1848. And we're going to define what democratic ideals mean in this new society. We're going to take power out of the industrial Northeast and really put power into the hands of Inner Appalachia, places like Kentucky and Tennessee, where those individuals are going to have a larger voice in the American experiment. And this is going to be in the face of rapid economic, territorial, and demographic changes, which we kind of outlined in that last slide here for period four as well. So unlike period three, where we had this nice kind of chronology, you have to look at period four. And while we are going to follow a little bit of a chronological timeline, there are a lot of things happening in the undercurrent. So while Andrew Jackson is pushing Native Americans westward under the Indian Removal Act, and the Supreme Court is deciding the constitutionality of Worcester versus Georgia, the Second Great Awakening is occurring, or Transcendentalism is underway. And so there's a more of a web of stuff that's happening at the same time concurrently, as opposed to this happened, and then this happened, and then this happened. So I'm looking for more of a continuity and change over time in period four, as opposed to cause and effect, although there are numerous opportunities for cause and effect, and great opportunities to show some comparing and contrasting in your formal writing. For today's discussion, though, we're going to really focus just on part one. Part one is going to be the Jeffersonian age, Jeffersonian democracy, and that's going to take us up to basically the corrupt bargain, the election of 1824. We'll talk about how John Quincy Adams and Henry Clay came up with a scheme, that's what Jackson will call it, that's going to secure John Quincy Adams' seat at the presidential desk, as opposed to Andrew Jackson. He'll come back in 1828. And then the second part of that, in the next discussion that we'll have, it's going to take us up from the corrupt bargain through the age of Jackson, through Second Great Awakening, and up to the Mexican-American War. I want to make period four rather easy and divide it up into four basic themes for our discussion. For period four, we're going to look at politics under Jefferson and politics under Jackson. We're going to look at economics under Jefferson, vis-a-vis Henry Clay's American system and the market revolution. And then we'll look at economics under Andrew Jackson, right? The nullification crisis under the Tariff of Abominations of 1828, alongside with the bank war that was underway, and then the subsequent panic of 1837. We're going to take a look at territory and compromise, Jefferson's Louisiana Purchase, couple that with anything west of the Rocky Mountains under Andrew Jackson, later on James K. Polk, and the acquisition of the Southwest Territories along with Oregon and Texas. And then for society and reform, that's going to be for part two, Transcendentalism, the reform movements, Oneida, the various utopian societies, if you will, the Oneidas, and looking at how life in this new American, destined American of sea to shining sea is going to be really filtered through that Second Great Awakening and that time period of Transcendentalism, which Americans pause and look back at themselves. That's going to be, the precursor to that's going to be the Era of Good Feelings under James Monroe. We'll take some time to talk about that as well. But without further ado, let's get to politics and look at the Founders' Age. I'm really going to divide this time period up amongst three of the Founding Fathers. I think that's the easiest way to take a look at the life of Jefferson, Madison, and Monroe. Jefferson's going to see a great expansion of the judiciary. Up to this point, the legislative branch and the executive branch had a lot of power. And so we're going to see a push by John Adams and the very last days of his presidency, pushing through a large number of Federalist judges to really shape the court. That's going to include really shifting the judiciary to a strong Federalist paradigm that's going to really examine states' rights. Jefferson is going to have some blunders in his presidency. While the Louisiana Purchase was a positive for the expansion of the United States, Jefferson's going to be really hit politically by this, because as a strict interpretist, as a Democratic Republican of the Constitution, Jefferson really is expanding the role of the government and the role of the presidency particularly. And we're going to see that also exacerbated through the Embargo Act of 1807, which really does damage to the economy, followed by the Barbary Wars, an offensive attack by the Marines in North Africa to go after those pirates who were commandeering the high seas and prohibiting American trade. So Jefferson, even on his own tombstone, would like to see things, and he articulated himself seeing that he was the president of the University of Virginia. He is the author of the Declaration of Independence and emissary to France, but nowhere on his tombstone will you see Jefferson as president of the United States. He himself will say in his own writings that those were some of the darkest days of his political career. James Madison, the one of the authors, if you will, of the Federalist Papers and the Constitution, the father of the American Constitution, is going to be at the chair on Pennsylvania Avenue during the War of 1812. He's going to vacillate on whether or not he wants to go to war, but he's going to be pulled into a direction by some war-hungry war hawks like John C. Calhoun and Henry Clay. He's going to be beset by the Hartford Convention, and I put already there in the parentheses to say we're talking about secession already. So some states in the Northeast are going to threaten to leave the Union if we go to war with Great Britain. And we're going to see as America continues to push past the Northwest territories that were acquired in 1787 and parceled out, continued conflict on the frontier, the Battle of Fallen Timbers and Tippecanoe, later on to become a campaign pledge under Tippecanoe and Tyler II when they run for president. And we're going to have the continued debate of tariffs of 1816. That's going to then follow by the Panic of 1819. We're going to see the Tariff of Abominations and then followed by the Panic of 1837 as well. You see a pattern? A little continuity and change over time. And followed by this time when the country really unifies, the Federalists, they're going to later come back to be the Whigs under Andrew Jackson, but the Federalists really are at this point diminishing as a political powerhouse. The power that they once yielded under John Adams is going to quickly go away, and we're going to find the country now unifying under one banner of a Democratic Republican Party, and James Monroe is going to ascend to the presidency under the election of 1820, and that's going to be followed by the Air of Good Feelings post-war of 1812 when we get our national anthem, and Francis Scott Key says, the rocket's red glare and the bombs bursting in the air. By 1800, though, the nation is strongly debating the size and scope of the federal government, particularly the judiciary, right? The Supreme Court itself under John Marshall is going to be looking at the meaning of the Constitution and how federal laws interact with state laws. There's that component of federalism that we talked about in period three. What power do the states have over the federal government? And drawing continuity and change over time, even to the contemporary time of 2020, even at the taping of this video, if you watch the press conferences with President Trump, he really is discussing the role that the federal government has in this COVID-19 crisis and really comparing that to what the role is of the various states. What are the governors responsible for and what is the federal government responsible for? So even today, continuity and change over time in COVID-19, we see the role of the federal government and states really having a continued and rather heated debate over that responsibility. We're going to be debating foreign affairs, particularly in Europe. We're going to see commandeering of the high seas with British impressment of U.S. sailors, along with pirates interfering with trade, and that's going to get us entangled, even in the infancy of this country, into foreign affairs, particularly offensive foreign affairs in North Africa, we'll see in just a few minutes, as well as supporting the French Revolution, which is underway. The Francophiles, particularly the Democratic Republicans, who even Jefferson says, you know, the tree of liberty must be shaken from time to time. And so he's going to really impress upon the nation that revolution is good. And we're going to see a strong support for French Revolution. But yet the Anglophiles of the Northeast, particularly the Federalists, are going to push back against that offensive, not only in the War of 1812, but in supporting Britain in their own war with France. And we're going to, of course, get to tariffs, right? Tariffs from whether or not it's a protective tariff that is going to be so high that it spurs domestic manufacturing, or just high enough that it generates revenue for the federal government. So what do those tariffs look like for northern manufacturers? How do those tariffs impact southern farmers? And that's really going to become at the forefront of the issue under John C. Calhoun and then Andrew Jackson's Force Act, that he's going to send troops down there and tell South Carolina, you have to pay this tax, almost like a mini civil war, if you will. There's that Embargo Act of 1807, where Jefferson locks up the country to really get us into a state of neutrality following the underpinnings of George Washington's final address to the nation, which he says, don't get into political parties and don't form foreign alliances. And of course, you know, Jefferson trying to adhere to that principle is going to lock up the country of trade all over the case. There was the Non-Intercourse Act as well, which you could find in your investigation guide. Now, as the country expanded west, we're going to really see a deepening of that regionalism or that sectionalism. I've told you in your formal writing, any of the isms or the ations. So if you throw in some regionalism and sectionalism, that's going to really add some weight to your writing, and showing that this is going to be how the country is going to deepen from a demographic standpoint, from a political standpoint, and certainly from an economic standpoint, is one of the catalysts for even a few decades from now, the U.S. Civil War. We're going to be deciding whether or not we support not only the War of 1812 during Period 4, but after the age of Jefferson, that war debate's going to continue into the Mexican-American War. That debate of supporting war or protesting war is going to be found in the Spanish-American War after we get to the age of imperialism in Period 6 and the beginning of Period 7. Native Americans, how are we going to deal with Native Americans? And is the state responsible for removing Native Americans, again, under Worcester versus Georgia? Or is it the federal government? Because those reservations are under the umbrella of a federal treaty. Is it the federal government's responsibility to manage Native Americans? And of course, I put slavery in bold and underlined at the bottom. And it's visually at the bottom because it's not really on the forefront. Remember, Jefferson is a slave owner himself, as well as most of the founding fathers. And so we'll have some early underpinnings of abolitionism in the Quaker societies and in particularly places like Boston with John and Abigail Adams. But slavery really is going to come to the forefront after the Mexican-American War as being an issue of not necessarily Northern and Southern slavery, but how is slavery expanding westward. And that political partisanship, while dividing the country, at least under Jefferson, is going to slowly unite post-War of 1812, and we get to that era of good feelings. But by and large, there are sharp divides between the Federalists and the Democratic Republicans up to about 1820. Let's take just a few seconds to talk about the Judiciary Act of 1801. There is a lame duck Federalist-controlled Congress. Lame duck means that once you are elected, the person that is currently in power is considered a lame duck because any policies they pass aren't going to be very effective because the country is already setting up for the next person to take that leadership role. So for instance, the president gets elected in November. They get sworn into office in January. That period from November to January is kind of known as the lame duck period. I like to refer to them as seniors after spring break, right? As far as just kind of caring what happens to them or their situation, right? They've already done the work and the task at hand. So here we are with a lame duck Federalist-controlled Congress, along with a lame duck president like John Adams. And so he, in cahoots with that Federalist-controlled Congress, on the last days of office, appointed 60 Federalist judges known as the Midnight Judges. And of course, those federal judgeships are lifetime appointments. And so this was one last attempt because they saw an incoming Democratic Republican president to really control at least one branch of the government with the Federalist Party. And so Jefferson, being furious, of course, is going to later on prompt the discussion or the furthering of that under the famous and most famous of the Supreme Court cases, Marbury v. Madison, that's going to examine the power of the judiciary, in which the judiciary gets to determine the constitutionality of any acts put forward by Congress or any orders put forward by the president. Now, the Marshall Court, there's a number of Supreme Court cases in your investigation guide on page 7. I'm not expecting you to go through and memorize those Supreme Court cases like a Quizlet, because, again, in this exam, you're not going to have multiple choices. But I do want you to step back at a 30,000-foot view and see what these cases are doing to expand the role of the federal government and kind of solidify that 10th Amendment, right? The supremacy of the state governments over the federal government, but then the Supreme Court is really establishing the supremacy of the federal government over the states. So it kind of muddies the water a little bit, but really solidifies the importance of that federal government. So Marshall's Court overall is going to establish three basic principles: new powers of the judiciary, particularly supremacy over the states, and it's going to do its job to protect private property, something that's going to be very appealing to the Democratic Republicans and the farmers of the Deep South. So Marbury versus Madison, any 8th grade U.S. history student can tell you it's going to be judicial review. The executive and legislative branch are going to be subject to constitutional scrutiny and still very applicable to this very day. But if we stand back for just a second and look at these two additional cases, Fletcher versus Peck and McCulloch versus Maryland, overall, without getting into the weeds of each of these individual Supreme Court cases, they're just basically doing one simple task, and that is establishing federal supremacy over the states. So for instance, if you have a federal land grant, right, that's a grant that's been given to you under whether it be the Land Ordinance of 1785 or a contract that you have with the federal government over land management, the state cannot come in and upset that contract. from McCullough versus Maryland, particularly with the banks, even though there was a federal bank in Maryland, they tried to tax that bank. And the Supreme Court said any federal institutions within the states cannot be taxable. Those are independent, autonomous federal institutions. So land grants between the federal government and you have supremacy over state law. And any federal institution within a state has supremacy and cannot be subject to state taxes. And again, I go back to these other two additional cases. Dartmouth versus Woodward kind of expands that idea of land grants, taking it now to private contracts. So if you have a private contract, the state can't come in and usurp that private contract, showing that states can't violate those individual agreements that you have. Followed by Gibbons versus Ogden, there was a strong monopoly with steamboats in the Northeast there in New York and New Jersey. And because Congress regulates interstate commerce, right, this is a federal regulation, the states cannot break up monopolies, the states cannot interfere in those existing monopolies. And if there is a monopoly that is large enough to upset the financial structures of that particular state, it is going to be the job of the federal government to manage that monopoly breakup, right? Or that to prevent that monopoly from expanding. And one of the more laughable, I say, and I mean laughable, not ha-ha as in funny, but just ironic, is in this case of Worcester versus Georgia, in which Georgia tried to remove Native Americans, right? And the federal government steps in and says, you can't do that. And everybody's like, yay, the federal government really looking out for the ideals of the Native American. No, that's not what the federal government is saying. Georgia can't kick out Native Americans, but the federal government can. Okay. And so finally, when the Marshall Court rules on this, Andrew Jackson, of course, with great support, says Marshall has kind of set this stage now. Let's go ahead and finish the job and get those Native Americans out, in which 1/4 of all the Native Americans from the Choctaw to the Cherokees, from Florida to Georgia, south of North Carolina, were moved to Oklahoma, and 1/4 of them regrettably died over this period. Martin Van Buren actually oversaw most of the Trail of Tears, but it was the policies of Jackson that really pushed those through. So let's go back to Jefferson for just a second, the Barbary Wars of the early part of the 19th century. And you have to remember, right, that it is impeding upon trade. Impeding upon trade, I repeat one more time, when you impede upon trade, that's when the United States is really going to begin to launch an offensive. So it was those pirates that were intercepting ships from trading between Europe and other parts of the globe, like Latin America and the Caribbean, that, and it was the safe haven of those ships in North Africa that prompted the United States to storm the shores of Tripoli. And you'll remember, if you we played it in class, the Marine hymn from the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli. That's exactly what that offensive was. And so this is really an expansion of the federal government, and Thomas Jefferson showing his now more federalist stripes in this mindset. But again, it was the supremacy of the high seas, the control of the high seas, that we could really see is going to be the cause and the catalyst for the war. If I were to add complexity to this argument in your formal writing, man, you could talk about Mahan's sea power, naval sea power, the height of imperialism. Don't inhibit trade. And look at what was one of the last catalysts before we went to war in World War I. Wilson saw unrestricted submarine warfare as kind of the last straw before we engaged in the First World War. So really, don't impede with trade. That's the big lesson at the end. I'm not going to play PowerPoint karaoke with you here, but I just want to see that, for instance, of the War of 1812, we have a long list of causes that kind of get us there, both direct and indirect. And you've seen that, excuse me, just 1 second here. You're going to see that from in class when we talk about long-term causes of the American Revolution and immediate causes, long-term causes of the U.S. Civil War and immediate causes. Well, look, from the Northwest Ordinance and the French Revolution and those French entanglements with the Guinea Affair and XYZ, those are all going to kind of test the bounds of American foreign policy. But in page 8 of your investigation guide, it really highlights in that gray box 4 specific areas that give us, you know, a concern for the British presence in the interior of the country, and is going to get us to that second revolution, Revolution 2.0. British impressment of U.S. sailors. There's that Barbary War interference on the high seas. Those war hawks like Calhoun and Clay are really going to pull heartstrings of the nation and saying we do need to go to war. And finally, out west, In 1811, we see the Brits arming the natives in the Battle of Tippecanoe. And so this is going to be those forts that were unmanned from the French and Indian War still out there. So lest we forget, a lot of French, a lot of British, a lot of Native Americans still in around the Mississippi Delta, the Ohio River Valley, and that area. And so it's going to be one final straw. And of course, one of the war generals in the Battle of New Orleans is going to really make his name known, Andrew Jackson, General Jackson, and will ascend to the presidency under that popularity. Now that we've gotten politics out of the way, let's look at Henry Clay's American system. What I basically do with Henry Clay's American system is pretty straightforward. I say we got to get the money first, we got to put the money somewhere, and then we have to spend the money. So I repeat, we get the money, we put it somewhere, and then we spend it. So how do we get the money? There's those protective tariffs of 1824, promoting American manufacturing and raising revenue enough so we could put it into infrastructure. We're going to have now the second recharter of the bank. Alexander Hamilton's first bank is going to come into now the position of having to be rechartered every 20 years. So here's Henry Clay's second recharter of that, keeping the system running smoothly by providing a single currency and a place to put that money, also generating revenue for the bank and the government by lending out that money with interest. And then once we have that money in the bank, we need to provide significant infrastructure improvements like a national transportation system, tariffs, roads, and canals. And what does that infrastructure system look like? Well, you know, I think how just impressive it is that I can't even plant a boxwood in my front yard without breaking a sweat. And here they are digging an entire ditch from the Great Lakes to the Atlantic Ocean, greatly expanding commerce. So if there's no river, well, at least in the market revolution, they can make one. And of course, more like gravel paths, increasing the web of networking to allow commerce. You know, you start really having a good road system and that commerce getting stuff from market, getting stuff from the farms to market is going to really expand. And if you even notice here in Texas, you'll see like FM 1922 or FM 2236, that's farm to market road. Those are the same type of farm to market roads that were created in this market revolution. The introduction of railroads with the Baltimore and Ohio. So railroads are really going to expand in period five and explode in period six. But we're already starting to see some of the first steam locomotives making their way across the tracks. Unless we forget the factory system under Samuel Slater, that's going to be kind of the father of the factory system. Francis Lowell is going to introduce us to the Lowell factory system in Massachusetts. And I caution students to say that, you know, women working in the factory system really expanded women's rights. And I caution you by doing that because the conditions for women and the pay for women were not really expanding women's rights. Yes, they got out of the domestic front. We start to see women showing up in the industrial sector, but not so much that it's improving their working condition, so to speak. So now let's take a look at the territory and compromise, the third and final component of our discussion today. And Jefferson's Louisiana Purchase, again, any casual Googling of the Louisiana Purchase will see that we have doubled the size of the country and territory. This is great. This is good for the agrarian farmers, but it really provided a larger elasticity for Jefferson's view of the Constitution. So there's going to be some political ramifications for expanding Louisiana territory. We're going to see the Talmadge Amendment is going to be the precursor to the Missouri Compromise of 1820. You know, Missouri has enough residents to become its own state. And one of the issues from the Talmadge Amendment is to, and he was a senator that said, yes, Missouri can come into the nation, but with the slaves that they have, they can't bring in more slaves. So whatever slaves they have, that institution will have to die off naturally. Of course, that didn't pass, and it was refuted, but it just so happened that Maine wanted to come into the Union around the same time as Missouri. And so the easy compromise was, let's draw a line, and Maine can come in as free, and Missouri can come in as a slave state, even though they were north of the Missouri Compromise line of 3630. But this was at least a Band-Aid to kind of put over what a wound that is going to greatly expand under the Kansas-Nebraska Act and Bleeding Kansas and Henry Clay's Compromise of 1850 with the issue of slavery. So this is the first kind of beginning of drawing and what Jefferson is going to call, and you'll see this in your own DBQ documents, a death knell to the nation. Drawing a line in the sand is going to be much to our demise. And he was prophetic in that sense. And then finally, the Monroe Doctrine is going to be surfaced, written by John Quincy Adams, but under the Monroe administration, Once the Latin American territories got their independence, there was this opportunity for the United States to say that anything's happening in our sphere of influence, our Western hemisphere, Europe will not get involved in, and we won't get involved in European entanglements, at least until the latter part of imperialism, in which we see the Monroe Doctrine, particularly with our acquisition of Cuba and the Philippines. I shouldn't say acquisition of Cuba, but our acquisition of Cuba and the Philippines is going to kind of counter the Monroe Doctrine itself. So there's your map, just a big overall of you. One thing I want to draw particularly to your attention is this Oregon territory. James K. Polk is going to say 5440 or fight, because this is still claimed by Spain and Great Britain. And so we're going to really, you know, not go to war over Oregon, but this is going to be the counter to the annexation of Texas. And that line is going to be drawn here, and we'll give Great Britain under the British territory and later on the Dominion of Canada to the Brits, and we'll take this land under here, which now becomes modern day Idaho, Oregon, and Washington state. And then this, of course, is the Spanish territory, a hotbed of issue under Polk and that expansion. We've got down here along the Rio Grande, Zachary Taylor spilling blood on American soil, making that case not at the Nueces River, but at the Rio Grande. And we'll talk about that the second part of this discussion in the Mexican-American War. So just a brief recap from period three, Northwest Ordinance of 1787. There's Jay's Treaty of 1791. The country is rapidly expanding under Pinckney's Treaty of 1795, all the way up to the Mississippi River, which was still controlled by Spain at that time. And then there's that Louisiana Purchase. And this is part two of period four as well. I'm going to leave you with a slideshow here. And while I'm not requiring you to memorize the states when they finally came into the Union, but I want to see that once the floodgates were basically open, those states really started coming in at a rapid pace, 1 year right after the other, 16, 17, 18, 18, 18, 19, and then finally 18, 20, and 21. And so while these states came in at a rapid, rapid pace, it really allows us to answer this existential question: what is this rapid expansion going to do to shape our foreign affairs? How is this going to shape our politics? Certainly, how is it going to shape our economics? And what does culture look like this? You have to remember, Great Britain at the time really looks like this. I mean, the size of Great Britain is significantly smaller than that of the United States. France is basically the size of Texas. So the homogenous nature of their demography is particularly easy to manage. That's why monarchy works so well for centuries in these countries. But when you look at the size of the United States, just from a sheer physical geographic standpoint, it is definitely difficult to control the demography of the country, particularly with immigrants coming in from all parts of Europe, slaves that are living amongst the population, Native Americans, existing Europeans. And we're going to start to bring an influx of Chinese in as the railroad expands from the west going east out of California, and of course helping to prospect for gold out there in 1849. So the United States is going to see monumental cultural change during this time period. So there it is, your four major themes: politics under Jefferson, economics under Henry Clay and Jefferson, territory and compromise. And of course, we'll get to that society and reform, that duplicitous nature, that plurality of society that we'll see in the Second Great Awakening and certainly under Transcendentalism. All right, my friends, that's it for period four. I thank you for taking, again, time out of your busy schedule to join me. Hope this was purposeful use of your time and certainly helpful in understanding period four. And when we get back together next time, we'll talk about Andrew Jackson. In the meantime, be well and be wise and keep learning.